Hi, welcome to A Hot Take, a podcast where we feature new and trending authors and artists. My name is Jenna Green, a YA fantasy author, author of the Imagine series and the Reborn Mark series. With me is Miranda O, a contemporary chick lit author, and she's here to introduce our guest for today.
Hello, hello, Jenna. Thanks for choking on air for me. I really appreciate that. Now, today, in the honor of October and spooky season, we welcome Rich Davis. Now, he's the writer and curator of the underground horror sensation, The Cult of Dracula, from Source Print Press. Now, in a short period of time, he's built a reputation in the comic book industry as an innovator with a tireless work ethic. So welcome, Rich. We're so thrilled to have you today.
Thank you so much for having me, guys. And I think about 90% of my voice made it with me after New York Comic Con. So so I apologize. I don't sound as I don't have those dulcet baritones that I normally do, but I'm trying.
You know, I saw a few pictures of the event.
Right? And the raspy undertone definitely sets the mood again for the season.
I just coughed my way through the intro for the first time ever. So, you know, we're in good. That's never happened.
No, Jenna never jokes on air.
I don't know how to breathe or something.
That's usually my thing.
It's hard. It's like in and out, and you got to remember which order and which one you've already done. Mm-hmm, yeah, it's hard. I'm with you.
Exactly. I'm one of those people that can successfully choke on air, trip on flat ground, and fall up the stairs.
Yes.
So, hey, that's
okay. But I'll go back. Miranda O, a contemporary chick lit author. Author of the Chin Up, Tits Out series.
Hence the reason I can fall out up the stairs.
There you go.
You know, you got that mentality walking around with you.
I'm going to get a phone call about this later.
Okay, so now we're going to get right, we're going to get into the Cult of Dracula, which I'm guaranteed to call the Count of Dracula at some point.
It happens.
I'm going to try to get the marbles out of my mouth, but I want to get to know you outside of that first. So tell us a little bit about yourself, where you're from, and some of your interests and hobbies outside of Dracula.
Yeah. So I was born in a small town in Middle Tennessee called Sparta. It is the dead middle of the state and the absolute middle of nowhere. So if you know where Sparta is, that means you've driven through it on your way to either Knoxville, Nashville, or Chattanooga. It's a beautiful little small southern town tucked right at the foot of the Cumberland Plateau. A lot of hills, a lot of old coal mines, it's just a beautiful little small town to grow up in. And it certainly inspired, my style of writing. I went to college at UNCW in Wilmington, North Carolina. I lived there for many years on the beach, recently traded the beach for the mountains and came back to Knoxville. So very much enjoying that. I've done a lot of different things with my life. Most recently, I'm a comic book creator. I owned a theater. I owned a bar. I worked at radio, worked for a newspaper. I've worked for two presidential campaigns and one senatorial campaign. I think I might need a little bit of focus in my life, but my life's been a lot of things, but it's never been boring.
There's a saying that I always hear that it stands true to my life, and it sounds like it's going to stand true to your life, that moss just doesn't grow under your feet because you're constantly moving.
Yep.
It's good to get your hands in a little bit of everything. One, I think it, for a creator, experience gives us lots of juice to create, right? And, you know, being a jack of all trades and a master of none, it brings richness and culture to your life as well, instead of just kind of staying straight and narrow and only doing one thing.
Absolutely. I 100% agree. I mean, I have learned something new about myself and about the world from every career I've chosen to follow.
Now, big question. Beach or mountains? Because for me, it's beach all the way. But, like, I don't know if I could live there because Mother Nature scares me, so...
They each have their own unique charms. I'm one of the people, I actually do not like actually going to the beach. I like living at the beach, but I don't like going to the beach. Like, I like the fresh seafood. I like the smell of the salt in the air. I like the sound of the seagulls flying around. And I love the beach lifestyle. But I don't, I think in all the years that we lived in Wilmington, I think I probably went to the beach maybe five, six times. But you just kind of take it for granted. So I would probably have to say the mountains, but it's very difficult to say no to the gorgeous expanse of the ocean. I mean, it's, for some people, and believe it or not, some people have never seen the ocean, but just being up close and personal and seeing just how massive and majestic it is. It's pretty doggone incredible. But I can wake up, look out my back deck window and see very clearly why they call them the Smoky Mountains every single morning. So, I can't complain about either place I've lived.
It's like two picturesque backgrounds, like, and vastly different, but both breathtaking at the same
Yeah, for different reasons, but both wonderful.
Oh, that's awesome. Okay, so now that we got kind of a little bit about you not out of the way, but we've absorbed that. I'm interested. Have you always been into storytelling? I know you kind of dropped that you've done a whole bunch of stuff. Now, has storytelling always been kind of a passion for you?
My mom says that even as a little kid, I was prone to tell stories and to kind of entertain people. As far back as anyone can remember, I've been telling stories. I never had the courage to actually pursue a career as a storyteller, or as a writer, until much later in life, actually, when I owned the Brown Coat Pub and Theater in Wilmington, North Carolina. Then I began writing plays and I began writing screenplays, began working as a script doctor for some people developing their screenplays and their stage plays. So that's when I really figured out that maybe I could do this more seriously. But but I think my whole life I've got that natural entertainer, storyteller vibe to me.
My mom loved traveling with me because I could have three She-Ra action figures. And I mean, that was hours of entertainment. My sister was a horrible traveler, but I had my three She-Ras and that was okay.
Yep. You had your
Hours of
toys, you can make
adventures.
up all kinds of stories.
Oh yeah. Oh, I just talk. I never stop talking. So like I would look out the window and see a bug and then tell the people in the car a
Yeah,
story
ooh,
for an
squirrel.
hour about the bug,
A
right?
bug. I gotta save Etheria. What are you guys doing?
Right.
Or, it's best when you're not in a job that does have or that doesn't have a lot of creativeness in it, and you go back to work on the Monday and they sit you down, like your coworker sits you down and be like, all right, so I know your weekend was a story. Like, get your coffees, get your breakfast, let's sit down. Let's show up 10 minutes early so we don't get into trouble.
Because
But like we gotta
it's
talk
story
about it.
time. Gather
It's
around,
story
children, sit
time.
on the imagination carpet.
Crisscross applesauce.
Yep. That's funny, that saying, crisscross applesauce. So when I'm writing the script for issue four of Cult of Dracula, there's a scene where I have to describe a little girl sitting crisscross applesauce. And when I was growing up, that term we just went in a completely different way that's no longer socially acceptable. So I had to I was texting and calling and emailing everybody I could think of that might know, like, how do I describe this style of sitting with your legs crossed without offending everybody on the planet? And so they finally, someone who was a teacher told me about crisscross applesauce. I was like, that's it.
Grade one, two teacher right here. You could have
Nice.
phoned me. I would have been like, I say that like nine times a day.
Yeah.
I see, Jenna, aren't you proud of me though? Like, I pulled that out without asking you to.
Yeah.
I knew you would be proud of me for that.
I say
one.
Crisscross applesauce and easy peasy lemon squeezy.
I say that all. I love
all easy the time. Peasy lemon squeezy. All the time. Yep. And a Canadian one, like, I was like, oh, how's your day? I'm good. I'm trying to turn a loonie into a toonie today. Like, mm-hmm. $1 into a $2. Or this, that, and bacon fat. I don't know where I got that one, but.
Okay. I've never heard either of those, but I'm
it must be Manitoba things because I have not heard either of those last two way over here in Alberta.
You know, hair flip, I made them up. No, I didn't. I picked them up from some sort of work environment. I don't know. It was fun either way. Now, okay, so storytelling obviously has been something that we do see a lot of it in our guests and in ourselves, that we're always kind of a version of a storyteller. Now, you have been dabbling in a bunch of different mediums over the years. And for me, I think it's hard enough to write from a different point of view when I'm writing my different series. But how do you find writing or creating in a multitude of mediums? Is it difficult? Can you just snap on and snap off? Or is it like you got to compartmentalize?
They each have their own unique set of challenges. Compartmentalization works quite well for me. And I do tend to kind of stay in a similar lane because writing for a comic book script is very similar to writing for a screenplay. Because when you're writing a screenplay, you are writing in pictures and you're writing in such a descriptive way that your director of photography knows how to set up the camera. And that's very similar to the style of writing a comic book. Now there's I have to preface that by saying that there are many different approaches to writing comic book scripts, and in the industry there is no consensus of which one is the right way to do it. There's the Marvel way, which Stan Lee is most famous for, where it's, you know, he would write a paragraph that says, Peter swings out of the window of the Daily Planet, sees a giant monkey flying across the sky, and somebody throws a brick at him. And then Jack Kirby or Steve Ditko would then take that paragraph and draw an action page based on that. The way I choose to write my scripts is a bit more like a screenplay. Like, I break it down scene by scene, you know. Page one, five panels, exterior, creepy church compound, night. And then I do panel 1.1, 1.2, 1.3, 1.4, 1.5. And then I'd write a very detailed description about what I see in each one of those panels. And luckily, I've worked with some artists that absolutely love that approach because they feel like, you know, we don't have to have a lot of the edit meetings because I've communicated with them very clearly what I want to see. The downside of that is it takes me probably three times as long to write a script as someone who writes it the Marvel way, because it's real easy just to go through and write 24 paragraphs and say, this is what happens, and then you throw some dialogue in there. But the way I like to do it requires a very strong and collaborative relationship with my writer, with my artist, excuse me, because we are, you know, we're constructing the page the same way that that I would construct the scene setups with a director of photography. Mm-hmm. So it is difficult to switch mediums. Like I've tried to sit down and write in a novelization style. It doesn't come naturally to me anymore. So that's a challenge. I think I've locked myself pretty much in this lane for at least a while. And if I wanted to switch back to writing more of a traditional, you know, like a novel or a book, I think it would take me a lot of work and a lot of effort to get there.
Yeah, it's, I definitely concur. Sorry, Jenna, go ahead.
Well, you're assuming what I was about to say was brilliant. You're taking a gamble there. I was just saying that, like, even obviously Miranda and I are novelists, but we write very differently. She has to have like a big chunk of time, no distractions, focus. I write in like 20-minute sprints whenever I can find that time. Right?
Oh, wow.
We both write books. So you have to find your style and your,
Yeah, you got to find your jam. You know, I'm a little kind of right between you guys on that. I do block out time, and this is the only way I know to keep up with the serialized nature of a comic book. Because you are every month you have to have a new issue out, and so every day I need to produce at least one page to keep up with that. So I do block out my time where I spend office hours. You know, treat it like I'm a college professor. Like I have office hours from 7 a.m. to 11 a.m. and then I take a break and then I'm back at like 4 and then I stay until 7 or 8 and then I may stay for the rest of the night too. But there are many times that I've blocked myself during those office hours where I can't think of a thing to write. So I sit there and just type the same sentence over and 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 over again. Music helps. I listen to a lot of what most, if you see the types of comics that I write, the types of music that I listen to while writing would probably surprise you, but I do draw inspiration from some very strange places.
Interesting.
I feel like it's like classical or like K-pop now, like something completely different.
Well, it's funny. So a lot of times it's actually dubstep remixes of classical music. Like,
isn't that the best to write though?
It's amazing. I don't know what it is,
because there's a constant, it's a good beat. So you're always moving to something, but then the classical kind of takes you over here and takes you over there. And then
it's
all of a sudden
so cool.
It comes out of your fingers and you're like, whoa, but I concur with you. Hands down.
It's amazing where you can pull inspiration from. And, you know, I think there's something to exactly what you said, the rhythm of a dubstep, that beat, and what I do, and I learned this trick from Brian Michael Bendis. He will, like, he'll have a playlist of three songs and he puts them on repeat. And when he's writing, he just repeats them because the repetitiveness of it, he says, hypnotizes him and forces him to focus. And I find if you do something like dubstep or like a workout mix or something like that, because you've got that constant beat going, it accelerates the hypnotism. And once you hypnotize yourself, you know, you can sit there and write for hours and not even notice it.
Oh yeah, it's absolutely. I'm with you 150% of the way when it comes to those music choices. But you know, roommates in the past or people that I've like family that I've lived with, they're like, this is not what you normally. I was like, don't talk to me. And I have like the big headphones on, and it is loud. Yep. Yeah. So it's like, how do you concentrate? Like, if I ever write in public, like a Starbucks, like I can only imagine the side eyes that I get. So I tend to not go write in public for that reason.
Yeah. I try to avoid that too. Like I do keep I keep an app on my phone where anytime I have an idea, and a lot of times it's when I'm listening to music, but wherever I am, if I have an idea, I stop, I open up the app and I write it down. And I store it that way. And I've built entire scenes, you know, over the span of several days just from ideas that I've had like that. But it's kind of the old version of the yellow notepad and pencil that like Stephen King and a lot of other writers carry around.
Yep.
I have to do that because I drive an hour for work, you know, to work, and then an hour home. And so I'm not like actively trying to, you know, but every once in a while an idea comes up and then you're like, ugh. So sometimes I record it like, you know, with the hands-free, but other times I just pull over and I've written stuff on backs of receipts.
Oh yeah.
Etched it into the window. Like, and they find, and then you draw a dragon. And
wherever the inspiration hits you, you got to
write it on my arm. Then my kid gets mad at me. But what's interesting is that you have to produce so consistently, like Miranda and I write series, but when you write a book, even though the audience might be like, when's the next one coming out? They don't expect it that next week. They might want it.
Right.
But they also are very realistic. Like, you can't. Right. So that's something we've never really talked about that or tackled that.
No, we haven't.
And you are writing, so The Cult of Dracula is going to be a 6-issue series?
Yeah, so Cult of Dracula issue 6 came out in August. So it's all out now. The collected trade paperback edition comes out Halloween weekend. And then volume 2, Rise of Dracula, hits store shelves in December. So Puis Calzada, my artist, just recently finished the pencils and inks, and Alex finished the colors, Dave finished the letters for Rise of Dracula issue 1, which we released a special sneak preview of at New York Comic Con this past weekend. And so now he's moving on to start on Rise of Dracula number 2. And I am currently locking down, doing my final edits on Rise of Dracula number 4, the script. So each one, the Dracula saga was intended to be told in 3 blocks of 6 issues each. And we may actually end up expanding that because the audience wants some one-shots that tell the stories of the origin stories of 3 of the characters, Dracula's brides. They found them quite interesting. So we'll probably end up doing that. And then Sourcepoint, my publisher, is interested in me doing a spinoff series that visits Dracula at different times in her history. Because the way we present Dracula, it opens up an infinite world of storytelling, because we can tell a Native American story with the Wendigo, we can tell an ancient Assyrian story, we can tell an ancient Greek story with the Lamia. There's so many different places we can go and tell completely different stories. So Sourcepoint's very interested in that. I just, I don't know how long I want to stay in the Dracula universe before I kind of shift off and do something else and maybe come back to it.
Right, because you know, you have other interests and passions. But the question of the hour, which Miranda hinted at earlier, why Dracula? Like, you could have adapted many other things. So why Dracula?
You know, I have been obsessed with vampires since I don't remember when I wasn't obsessed with vampires. And vampires and serial killers, for some reason, have always fascinated and terrified me. And really and truly, they're not so very different from one another. So when I set out to write Cult of Dracula, I remembered an interview I saw with Stephen King many, many, many years ago. And he said, the secret to writing horror is to write about what scares you. So it was just a natural fit to write about vampires and combine that with cults and serial killers and people who manipulate others to do terrible, terrible things in their name. So that's really where the genesis for the direction that we took Cult of Dracula came from. It just goes back to those childhood fears. And I even managed to work in my my terrible, terrible arachnophobia, because some of the vampires are spider inspired. So yeah.
I like to say
on the book, from the nightmares of Rich Davis, because everything you see in here, I have already seen in a nightmare once or twice.
Spiders give me the heebie-jeebies. I sprayed one with Raid in the crack of my door. Sprayed it. I closed the door and I was like, okay, go back to it. You coated it with Raid. It will be dead. And I went back and it was gone. It disappeared. It didn't die.
I have to move.
Yeah.
And it was like one of those hairy creatures too. Like, I know that in Canada, we don't get like the poisonous ones that could throw you into the hospital.
It doesn't matter. They're creepy.
Like, mm-hmm. But they're still creepy. Nope.
Yep.
Nope.
I have a standing armistice with all the spiders in the world. As long as they stay out of my sight, I will leave them alone.
Yes.
So just stay away. And I still I'm strange. If you see the types of comics that I write, this will sound strange, but I refuse to kill them. I won't kill bugs. I won't kill spiders. I can't do it. I just can't take a life like that. So with bugs, I will capture them. I'll catch them in a cup or in a napkin and take them outside. With spiders, I have to get somebody else to come do that.
That's my husband's job. Or I used to work with older students and I had assigned spider killers, but now I have younger ones. So we have to run across the hall and get some of the older ones. And, but I tell them if possible, if you are brave enough in my class, I'm on a need to know basis and I don't need to know, just get rid of it.
Exactly. I tell my exterminator, you know, when he comes, you know, every 3 months, you know, they go under the house and spray in the attic. And I was like, no matter what you see, don't ever tell me about how many spiders you see in there, because if you do, I will never set foot in this house again.
But why do you have to get it done every 3 months? Is it the location that you live?
Yeah. It's just, here in the South. Now. Yeah. Right. I live in the Southeast. Summers are horribly humid here. I mean, I think the humidity today is 68% outside. So it is punishing, in the summer, especially. But that also does provide a great environment for a great number of insects and spiders. So every 3 months, we just have the exterminator. They come and spray around the house to keep things out.
Great. Oh, I feel great. Faint. I'm going to switch the. I can't do this. I'm so arachnophobic. I'm going to switch the subject back to writing because I can't handle it.
Yeah. Yes, please. Let's take a tangent back.
I can't do it. So, well, we only have so much time left and I'm debating which question I want to ask on my list, but I think as the English major in me and I think I got to ask, what are the challenges of adapting a well-known figure or where well-known, I guess, mythology, right? Mm-hmm. I mean, you've already said the advantages that you can transfer it to different cultures, but there have to be some challenges as well.
You know, that's a great question. And nobody ever asked me that either. So when I went into it, I thought that taking a public domain, well-known character, probably the most reproduced character in all of fiction, literally been reproduced thousands of times. I thought that would make it easy because the work had already been done. All the character research, everything is already there. You know who Dracula is. And what I discovered very quickly was that legacy, it made it much more difficult. It's kind of like when Windows was trying to design its new operating system, but they still had to design a system that fit with all the older computers, the people that hadn't made the upgrade yet. So I had to really focus on presenting this character in such a way that was true to Stoker's intents and the themes and the things that he wanted to say and what the audiences expect, but also would present this character in a completely unique way that made it an interesting story that would ask people to come read my comic rather than just going back and reading or watching one of the classic Dracula movies. So it was very challenging to find a unique perspective for Dracula and still respect what Stoker intended. And I think we managed to walk that tightrope quite well. Because when you look at the all six issues of Cult of Dracula and what we're doing with Rise of Dracula, all of Stoker's themes are there. They're just jumbled up and shifted around and presented from a more modern and a sharply feminist perspective. And so and people are not expecting that out of Dracula, because Dracula is usually presented in a very anti-feminist way.
Very masculine, yeah.
Very, very masculine, even though that's not exactly what Stoker intended. You know, Stoker himself very strongly rumored to be closet homosexual, with having an affair with Oscar Wilde. And a lot of people believe that he wrote Dracula to expose the hypocrisy in the British Parliament, the Lords, who were all prim and proper and moralistic during the day, and then at night they're putting on ball gowns and wigs and, you know, having debauched evenings in Molly houses. So, but that's the same exact thing that they imprisoned Oscar Wilde for, and then these other people get to make the laws. So there's a lot of evidence that Stoker really wanted to give the middle finger to all of Victorian society, specifically the House of Lords and Parliament. So, but yeah, we see Dracula traditionally as this very sexually charged, masculine, seductive figure. And that's great. And we can still play with all that. But I wanted to do something a little bit different. And I think when you shift the narrative to a feminine point of view, that was very challenging too, to be able to do, to get into that headspace. But I think it changes the story, and some of the things that Dracula does throughout the story take on different meanings when it's a woman doing them versus when it's the traditional male role.
I like that. And that's what I kind of suspected. I was like, well, because I mean, with fairy tales, there have been thousands of adaptations. And so how do you make it new and different? You got to find a different angle, but the themes stay the same. Red Riding Hood, it's all about vulnerability and sexuality, and you know, and so you just find those themes or that allegorical kind of thing that they were trying to get at, and then you can just either modernize it or shift genders and things like that. And so because it's been done, like not Dracula so much, but you know, you can do that with any piece of literature. I mean, Shakespeare's
You know? I mean, Shakespeare himself, he didn't write anything original. He stole all of his ideas from existing stories and songs and folklores and just reimagined them. So
he made better names for them. Hamlet from Offlet. Like I'd rather, better names and go. But yet you can still, he gets credit because he had to tweak and change and adapt. And so it's almost more challenging to, or a different challenge maybe, to take something existing and have that truth to it, that authenticity. And you're right, you said it was like a fine, fine line. And that's why I don't do that. I don't write history. I don't write anything true to life. I write fantasy, and anything that doesn't make sense, I'm like, well, that's because I made up a whole new world. So I don't do what Brenna does, and I don't do what you. It's Matt, I don't have to be like, no one's coming at me and being like, well, a castle isn't formed like that. I'm like, it is in this world. And then they can't be like, oh, well, that's not how, like, I don't even anymore write about, like, I used to do the elves and the dwarves, but people are like, well, they're supposed to be like this and this. I'm like, okay, nuts to that. I'm going to make my own because I don't have that.
Something different,
I'm very, very impressed that you have that skill that I lack.
It does. It takes a very special skill, and it starts, I think, with one passion and follows up with like this true, again, passion to just dive into the research. Like, you have to know Dracula inside out, sideways, upways, backways, always, in order to chew it up, marble it out, spit it out, and make it good some way else, you know? But you're like, not just a different way, but like literally, it's like that. Have you ever seen that Leftover show on Netflix? Probably not.
Very good.
And they take a leftover of tacos, and their challenge is to make it look like something else. That's exactly what you're kind of doing here, right? You're taking a taco and trying to make an Italian dinner out of it, some way, shape, or form.
And you've got to know not only Dracula, but also, you know, you've got to know, or at least I felt I needed to know, everything around Dracula, everything that influenced Stoker. Like, you've got to know Carmilla, and you've got to know Varney, and you've got to know Count Ruthven, and you've got to know all of the different vampire mythologies and all the different folklores that he researched on his journey to creating Dracula. And then you also have to know, you know, you have to know Victorian society. You have to know the structures and the social norms, and you have to know the hypocrisy that he was aiming out. So you've got to know all about the Molly houses, and you've got to know, you know, it's not just, you can't just go watch the 92 Francis Ford Coppola movie and sit down and write a new incarnation of Dracula. You've got to research. I mean, hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of hours of research went into creating this story.
Totally.
Yeah, you could write a thesis on this. Like,
probably could. Really? I don't want to, but I could.
He's like, no, thank you.
No, no thanks.
Academia scares me.
Well, it's been such a pleasure visiting with you. I'm an English major, and I was like, wait, I'm learning more about Bram Stoker. I thought I was a good student. Okay. So, I mean, that was great. My little English major heart got a thumping. I didn't like the spider part so much, but we regrouped. Just before we go, can you share with our listeners and viewers where they can find you? Like, not your house, but on the social media and your websites and all those wonderful connections.
See, I'm glad you clarified because I was about to send you like a Google Maps link.
Oh, okay. Yeah. No
pin of my location.
I'll open up location sharing now. No. So it's super, super complicated. I made this so difficult to find me online. It's Cult of Dracula Comic on everything.
And we'll have that in the link below on the podcast description as well for those who want to follow you, Rich, and find your work. So we want to thank you again for sharing with us this evening and giving me the little heebie-jeebies on spooky season.
My pleasure.
Yeah, we had an absolute blast with you. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thanks for having me, guys. I had a good time.
Thank you. Just before we wind up, we need to say a big thank you to our show sponsors. So thank you to the Authors Library Network and Creative Edge Publicity with Mickey Mickelson. And of course, the biggest thank you to all our listeners and all our viewers. Thank you very much for tuning in. Bye.